Yeah, so we do.
Yeah, okay. Okay. My task is to talk about light pollution from the point of health and physiological impact. But I'm not sure how the presentation will work, so forgive me some mistakes. Anyway, as you can understand, this is the multidisciplinary forum, and if there are some biologists or some ecologists watching or listening to me, I have to apologize for the scholar simplicity of my talk. It will be very easy to understand, and also I will not talk long. I would like to start on the next slide by showing the increase in published papers about the detrimental effect of light, nocturnal light over the years on health, and also on ecosystems, which is on the next slide. And you can see the increase, enormous increase of interest in this topic within the last 20 years, which coincides very well with two major events in human history, which are depicted on the next slide. that happens almost concurrently. Could you please switch to the next slide? No. Oh. Can you hear me?
Yes, we do.
Yeah, okay, but if I would like to switch to the next slide. How can I manage that?
Okay. Then tell me what I did it, but it didn't work. So just a moment, please.
It's okay. Now I can see the next slide, which I want to talk about, but it goes, you know, a bit slower. Okay. I want to link this slide to the next one and to say that the increase in interest in a detrimental effect of light pollution on physiology is associated very well with these two events, which start around the year 2000. Okay, it is too far. Okay, stay at this slide. Baby can stay at this slide. I have some animation there, so it will be much more difficult in a while. The introduction of LED lightings into public environment started around 2000. It was a huge impact of the technical engineering to the natural environment. And together, it happened almost concurrently that we discovered intrinsically photoresponsive retinal ganglion cells in retina, which exist in majority of live beings. On this slide that you can see now for sure, because I can see it, you see a schema of the retina with rods, cones, and these intrinsically photoresponsive retinal ganglion cells, which are in the red cycle, and some plexiform layers within these two cells. These cells integrate information from rods and cones together with information coming from melanopsin for specific opsins, which is contained in these ganglion cells. And their axons or fibers send the signal to the brain parts, which differ from the brain parts responsible for image forming vision. So this pathway, which is made by the axons or fibers from these specific ganglion cells, is called non-image forming pathway and leads to various brain centers, which are responsible for homeostatic processes, cognitive regulation, and also the major the major target is the suprachiasmatic nucleus, the circadian clock, which you can see in at the next slide. Okay, circadian clock. And what is the circadian clock with the circadian system? Circadian system consists of major circadian clock in the suprachiasmatic nuclei in the brain, and peripheral clock everywhere in the body. If you click now, you will help me to explain that this big circadian clock generates rhythms in electrical activity in humoral signaling and drives the peripheral clocks in the body, in the brain, and also the peripheral clocks in tissue organs. And one of the major output, it will be in second bubble. You will see that the major output pathway goes to pineal gland, a small endocrine gland in the brain, which produces melatonin. Melatonin is produced only at night and only in the darkness. So these both conditions has to be fulfilled for the melatonin release. It has to be night at the dark and darkness together. Otherwise, the melatonin release is suppressed. Also, you will see, maybe perhaps you will hear more from Professor Zeman about peripheral clocks in bodily organs, how they are shaped, how their function is influenced by the light at night. We have a clock in every tissue and every organs in the body, and these clocks are responsible for regulation of majority of physiological processes. Now I would like to concentrate more to the eye. As we know that suprachiasmatic nucleus or the circadian clock can generate circadian period, which is really circadian, which means that the period doesn't correspond fully with solar cycle, period of solar cycle. This clock has to be resetted or perpetually resetted by light die cycle from the environment. This is important to understand that we call this process solely photic entrainment, only photic entrainment, but it means that, and if you can click for the last complicated animation, it is the contrast between day and night, which is the synchronizer, which is the information for the brain centers and for the biological clock. The contrast is important, and higher the contrast, better function of the clock and better the health of the organism. Why? You can, yes. One of the problem with light at night concerns the amplitude of the circadian rhythm. On the bottom figure, you can see melatonin rhythm, schematically drawn melatonin rhythmicity with relatively high amplitude, and core body temperature rhythmicity is also some amplitude, and both amplitudes are strictly compromised by a lowering contrast between day and night, which is also somehow depicted by the intensity of the color here and here. This lowering amplitude is usually associated with sleep disorders, with some sleep problems, but the problem is more complicated, and all these pathophysiological consequences of long-term amplitude reduction can be summarized under the term of accelerated senescence. So low amplitude is typical for aging, and accelerated senescence can be a term which can summarize all these negative impacts of lowering amplitude over the longer period of life. On the next slide, you can see probably better known problem of light at night, which is the suppression of melatonin release. This is an example of a group of adolescents that spent one night in at candles, which is depicted by the black line, and they spent the second night under the normally lit room, and you can see the difference between melatonin level in the saliva samples. This is the same group of people, but just under different conditions. You may say that the night light was relatively high in the study, but there are important paper from the last year that states that sensitivity to melatonin of melatonin to light varies in human over an order of magnitude. With the next click, you may see the citation of this work. The most sensitive individual respond to 6 lux of light. The least sensitive individual 350 lux, and this is very important information also for the discussion with public, and to understand that humans are extremely variable in the sensitivity to light. Melatonin signal. Melatonin is very important for various functions in the body. It is important for seasonal reproduction of animal, or even all seasonal changes in the nature. It regulates sleep-wake cycle. It is potent antioxidant. It is agents which is anti-inflammatory or anti-tumoral. This is a big chapter which study or big group of scientists, big number of laboratories study the effect of melatonin as an oncostatic. And from this is pretty clear that the list of functions is really long. So now there will be more complicated slide. As I say, circadian clock regulates various physiological processes in the body. It drives melatonin rhythmicity and clock regulates sleep, and all together these three factors regulate majority of physiological processes. So it is not surprising if disturbed clock function by unclear or vague signals from external environment, suppressed melatonin, disturbed sleep leads to variety of so-called civilization diseases like cancer growth, psychiatric neurodegenerative diseases, diabetes, hypertension, and some others. Also, on the next slide, there will be a second part of this figure. There will be also we have to consider that there is a direct effect of light at night, which can be hidden into the terms of negative positive phototaxis, and also together with melatonin it affects reproduction, migration, hibernation, and leads to changing biodiversity, and this is direction to ecology more than physiology. The problem of light at night doesn't concern only adult animals and this accelerating aging, but also developmental processes in the brain. This figure shows experiment in which young animals were bred or housed in constant light from P0, which means day of delivery, day of birth of the animal, and they were in constant light until P21, which means the end of development of circadian clock, and then since 21 they were released back to the LiDAR conditions. With complete darkness at night, and they were tested at P90, which is adulthood for these animals. And this graph shows the increased anxiety-like behavior in these animals, which grew up in light at night conditions. This is repeatedly observed result. We did our own experiment just to see and set our experimental condition, but the increase of anxiety behavior is quite enormous, and adult animals, and only this short exposure within the critical period of life of the brain development is important for development of increase of anxiety behavior. On the next slide, you can see when we looked at the amplitude also in gene expression, it will be on the next slide. We look at the brain structures and we check the gene expression in various brain structures. It's too big again, probably, and doesn't want to show up. So before it starts, before it becomes to be visible, the point of the next slide, which you probably can't see, is that we observed extremely lower amplitude in gene expression in brain structure called hippocampus, which is the brain area responsible for memory formation and also for development of anxiety. So we see the blunted amplitude, and which suggests, yes. This is the structure of hippocampus in the mouse or red brain, responsible for memory formation or some type of anxiety. And you can see a gene expression in this brain structure in animals which were housed under a normal condition of light at night, of dark at night, and light at day, and conditions of constant light. And you see decrease amplitude of the rhythmicity in gene expression in various genes, which I am not going to explain, but just to show that even from the developmental point of view, light at night play some role in maturation of brain circuits, and it's important for development of normal brain structure. So I would like to show several last figures. There is also some animation. Picture try to explain that our biomedical research of this type, of the type I showed you before, always tends to be interpreted in relation to humans. It's human-centric, and in our laboratory condition, we do not distinguish whether we will interpret it towards the light pollution or towards this indoor human behavior. It depends on intensity, on light spectrum we can change in the lab, and so on. So for biomedical research, both these situations are the same. But when we think about solutions, how to avoid or how to diminish this negative effect of light at night, the solution differ. This is more ecological problem, this is more medical or hygienic problem, and which are in responsibility of different authorities and should be regarded like that. Sometimes we face the questions from some part of lighting engineers that they don't have to solve this problem because people behave this way, and this is important to have argumentation to somehow disconnect these two situations in looking for some solutions. Another thing I would like to say at the end is that our animal laboratory models are close to the wild living animals, to the wildlife. They are mostly nocturnal rodents, and we see that light at night can induce various pathophysiological effects to our animal models, and we usually interpret them direction to human, but we should also think about that this result must inevitably concern the wildlife itself, and that even wild animals may suffer from civilization diseases and may be strongly affected, and their fitness and well-being can be compromised. So I am approaching the end, and there are the last slides just to mention that I didn't talk about spectrum. We are in the Czech Republic, we are facing the never-ending debate whether this figure is correct, whether the spectral sensitivity of melatonin suppression zone is accurate, and also what is the exact value of intensity that should not be overcome to keep the human healthy. And I am very grateful for the figure I want to show on the last slide, which is quite new figure. Maybe some of the maybe the authors of the figure are listening to me now. This seems to be consensual conclusion about the intensity which affect the circadian clock or health of the different type of animals, and can be somehow used for the discussion with authorities and discussion with public. So I would like to thank you for your attention, and I'm looking forward to discussion.